The tabernacle is the greatest revelation of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. Yet many people have never understood the magnitude of its symbolism. On today's program, we go to the Holy Land, where Pastor John Hagee incorporates a special chart to explain the construction and meaning of the tabernacle of God.
I want to welcome every one of you who are here and the millions of you who are watching by television around the nations of the world. We are in Israel, the land of the Lord, and we're going to be teaching today on the tabernacle. This is first of three teachings, and I assure you it's going to be the most exciting and the most intense Bible study you've ever heard in all of your life. It's always a delight to be in the nation of Israel. Israel is the place where Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was born. He is the Lord of glory. He is the light of the world. And the exciting news is he's soon coming back to this nation to rule and reign for 1,000 years. As I teach today on the tabernacle, immediately I want you to capture these thoughts in your mind, that every detail of the tabernacle was designed by God himself. Please do not think that Moses is the architect of the tabernacle, because God is the architect of the tabernacle. The tabernacle is a physical revelation of Jesus Christ. Say that with me. The tabernacle is the physical revelation of Jesus Christ and his plan of redemption. In Exodus 25, God gives to Moses instructions for how to build the tabernacle. And in verse 40, God said to Moses, "See to it that you make them," meaning every article of this tabernacle that you have before you, and you're holding it in a pictogram. And those of you who get this tabernacle series, we will give you this color pictogram so that you can see every detail of this tabernacle. God said to Moses, "See that you make it according to the pattern which you were shown in the mount." And then in Hebrews, the 8th chapter and the 5th verse, this is very important. Paul writes, "Who serve the copy and shadow of heavenly things." In other words, the tabernacle is something that God placed on earth that is a replica of something that he has in heaven. As Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle, for God said, "See that you make all of these things according to the pattern which was shown to you on the mount." Please understand that when Moses went to the Mount Sinai, he went there and he received the Ten Commandments. But he also received from God the architectural plans for the tabernacle. How important is this tabernacle to God? Because every detail of this is given by God. Every fabric, every board, every metal, there's gold, there's brass, there's silver, every piece of furniture, the four coverings that go over the top of the tabernacle, all of these speak of the Lord Jesus Christ. Every detail, every color that's used, every lampstand, the light of the lampstand, all of this is a revelation of Jesus Christ. Get this thought in your mind. God gives one chapter to the story of creation. God gives less than one chapter to the Ten Commandments. And then God gives 50 chapters in Scripture for the building of the tabernacle. This is done in the Pentateuch and the book of Hebrews. Now, if God gives 50 chapters to something in the Bible, that something is very, very, very important. God is saying, this is top priority. This is the portrait of my Son. This is the plan of redemption, and I want you to get it. When Jesus came to this earth, John 5:46, and he began to speak to the Jewish people for the first time, he said to them, "Moses wrote of me." Say that with me. Moses wrote of me. When did Moses write of Jesus? Jesus then began to tell them all of the things that were in the tabernacle that they had been doing for hundreds of years, centuries, that literally were a physical revelation of who he was. Jesus then said in Luke 24 and 27, and beginning from Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all of the scriptures the things concerning himself. Jesus went through this tabernacle from the front gate to the mercy seat and demonstrated to them the revelation of himself that they had been seeing in physical form all of these years that they had not been able to see before. Jesus told his audience, I was there. I was there in the tabernacle. I was at the door of entry. And this is the door of entry to the outer court of the tabernacle. He said, I was there because this is the door. And I am the only door to this tabernacle. I was there at the laver because I was there at the brazen altar, because on the brazen altar is where the sacrifice was made. And I was the Lamb of God slain from the foundations of the earth. I was there in the laver because the laver is typical of the Word of God. It was made of the mirror, looking mirrors of the women of the nation of Israel. And when you look into the Word of God, it reveals the will of God to you. It also reveals the imperfections in your life to you. Jesus was saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and God was the Word, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among men. That Greek word dwelt means tabernacled. Tabernacle. Jesus said, I have come to literally tabernacle with you. Paul said in Hebrews 9, Jesus was the tabernacle that was not made with hands. And then he talks about the entrance into the Holy of Holies, into the holy place and the Holy of Holies. This is the holy place. And this is the Holy of Holies. And when Jesus went through every feature of this diagram, he demonstrated to those who were listening to him that he was there. He was saying, I was the showbread. And this is the showbread right here in this middle picture to the right. I'm going to teach on each of these as we go through this. For I am the bread of life. And he said, you saw me in the 7 golden candlesticks because I am the light of the world. This golden candlestick was made out of one solid stick of gold, and it was beaten because Jesus Christ was beaten for our transgressions. By his stripes we are healed. And then he goes then to the altar of incense, which was the place of prayer. Jesus is saying, and God is saying, that the highest station of every believer is intercessory prayer. It's the last station before you go into the Holy of Holies, where you literally get into the presence of God. And then when you get into the Holy of Holies, where the ark is, where the angels are over the ark, where there is a mercy seat covered with gold, and inside this box there is a golden bowl of manna, and then there are the 10 commandments, the second ones that God made Moses do because he lost his temper and broke the first ones. And then there is Aaron's rod. God, as Jesus was saying to all of those who were listening to him, I was there. I was there at the showbread. I was there at the altar of incense making intercession for you. I am the golden lampstand because I am the one that is bringing the light to the world. I was there in the Holy of Holies. It was my blood that was being poured over the mercy seat right here. Why is this so important? Because in this ark is the law. And the law says that if you sin, you die. There is no alteration in that. The wages of sin is death. That has never changed. But what is happening here in symbolism is that the blood of the Lamb is being poured over this mercy seat. And before God can see the law that demands your death, he has to look from heaven through the blood of the Lamb to see that judgment. And so his mercies are renewed every morning because he sees you through the blood of his Son. He cannot bring that judgment because the mercies of the Lord are renewed every morning. Mercy comes before judgment. Say that with me. Mercy comes before judgment. I know some people that need to remember that. He was saying, I was there in the four coverings that are over the tabernacle. You need to understand here that God walked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the garden. And God visited with Abraham at Mamre, but he lived in this tabernacle. He lived in the Holy of Holies. You have to capture that thought in your mind that this was the place that God dwelt on the earth. This is just not something that the Jewish people put together in the middle of the wilderness. This is where God lived. And because of that, David said in Psalm 65 and 4, "Blessed is the man that you choose that he may live in your courts." Blessed is the man that you choose that he may live in your courts. And then Psalms 84 and 2, "My soul longs, even faints, for the courts of the Lord, for my heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." And then in Psalms 84 and 10, "For a day in your courts is better than a thousand." David said, "I would rather be the doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked." Why? Because in his presence is the fullness of joy. Say that with me. In his presence is the fullness of joy. Listen to me. Our objective is to get into the presence of God. I'm going to go through this so many times into the next three teachings, it's going to be etched into your brain. But once you come through the door, and by the brazen altar, and through the laver, and go through the five posts, and through the Holy of Holies, where you bypass the bread and the light and the altar of incense, your objective is right here in his presence. In his presence. It is, you really have not gotten the essence of what heaven is all about until you get in the presence of the living God. Give the Lord praise and glory in his house. Now I want to show you the cross in the tabernacle. If you draw a line straight through the Holy of Holies beginning here, this is a continuation coming here, and this is a continuation coming here. So actually you start in the Holy of Holies and you bring the line straight down through the brazen altar. And then inside the holy place, draw the line from the light over to the bread. You have a perfect cross. The cross was secondly demonstrated in the tabernacle because the tabernacle was the center of where the children of Israel camped. There were 12 tribes camped around this tabernacle. There were three on the north, the south, the east, and the west. But when you read the book of Numbers, you see that the population of the tribes on the east were exactly double what they were on the other sides. So if you had a double length, double amount of numbers, you had a double length. So what you had, in fact, was stretching this way and this way and this way, the three sides of the cross, but this one was twice the length. Therefore, they saw the cross. That's why Balaam, when he was hired to curse Israel, and he went up into the mountain, and he looked down on Israel, and he said, "How beautiful are thy tents, O Jacob." There was nothing beautiful about those desert tents. They were covered with desert dirt. But what he saw was the cross. The cross was a very real message, even in the time of the tabernacle. Looking down on the camp of Israel, you saw that perfect cross. The tabernacle reflects the threefold nature of man as body, soul, and spirit. In the outer court, and this is the outer court right here, in the outer court, there is the sense dimension of man. Everything that you get here, you get by natural sunlight. This is what I call the reasoning factor of man. You can live your spiritual life in the reasoning factor, but you're never going to be a happy Christian just living here in the reasoning factor. When you go inside the holy place, these four animal skins totally remove every element of light, and the only light you can receive is from the seven golden candlestick, which is Jesus Christ, the message of which is revelation. So I'm saying to you instantly, and listen to me, there are two kinds of Christians in this stadium and two kinds of Christians who are watching this television program. The kind that is led by reason, meaning you live in the outer court, and those who live by revelation. You are in the presence of God, you're in the Word of God, and God is revealing Himself to you. Now let me clarify that very much. When you live in the dimension of carnal reasoning, the Bible says the carnal mind of man is enmity against God, meaning that your logic and God's wisdom is always at war. You must never limit God by your intellect. It's a little bit like a gnat pulling up beside a 747 and saying, "I'd like to be like you." Never limit God by your intellect or your experience. Let me give you some Bible illustrations where God was trying to draw people out of the reason dimension, which is the outer court, and trying to get them to live in the revelation dimension. God said to Moses, "Moses, what do you have in your hand?" He said, "It's a stick." He said, "Throw it down." The stick became a serpent. Then God told Moses, "Pick it up." Moses said, "You said what?" I mean, Moses had a hard time picking that up. I had a real hard time picking that up. But he did it because he was teaching him not to live in the reason dimension. Whenever Jesus was on this earth, he said to Peter, Peter, a professional fisherman, "Peter, I want you to go, and I want you to, we owe the IRS money. I want you to go fishing, and I want you to catch a fish. The first fish you catch, you're going to have enough money to pay your IRS bill." How many of you know that sounds just a little bit nutty? It really does. Peter went and did it. He had the money. He knew he was following an unusual person here because he wasn't following him in the sense dimension. He was following him in the revelation dimension. On Mount Carmel over here, you've already passed it on this tour. Elijah the prophet was having a contest between the kingdom of God and the false prophets of Baal. The false prophets of Baal were sitting around the table of Jezebel, telling her that she was right and she was such a vessel of God. They were spiritual prostitutes of which America is full, who are trying to be politically correct and accepted, who are preaching every kind of godless heresy known to man that's away from the Word of God. And so Elijah said, "Let's have a contest. Come out to Mount Carmel. We're going to find out who the real God is." And you know the story of how he mocked the gods of Baal. Said he's on vacation, he's a long way off. Scream a little louder, cut yourself a little deeper, act like the fools you really are, get with it. And when nothing happened, he said, "Now it's my turn in the afternoon." And he put his sacrifice on the ground, and God said, "I want you to put 12 barrels of water on your sacrifice." I'm going to tell you something, Elijah had a little problem here. I'm sure he got over in the corner and said, "Now God, I don't know how you folks in heaven start fires, but down here we don't use water." Carnal logic says that. But he did it. And the Bible says fire came from heaven and consumed the water and consumed the rocks. It was so totally consumed there was no doubt who was the God of Israel. I said all of that to say this. If all you ever do is live for the Lord in your logic dimension, yes, you're saved. Yes, you're going to go to heaven. Fortunately, by the grace and mercy of God, you're going to miss hell. But you're going to be the most bored Christian on the planet because you never get into the holy place where you live by the revelation of the light of God. God wants you to live by the revelation of what He has for you, because there it's very, very exciting. The holy place is the type of the soul where you live by revelation truth. Now, let me tell you of the high priest who went before the golden lampstand to receive the direct revelation from the Lord. When Israel wanted to do something, the high priest came and stood in front of this lampstand. The oil that was in these seven lampstands represent the Holy Spirit. I'll say more about that later. The light that came was pure light from God. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." This high priest had two diamonds on his shoulder. In this golden lampstand, there was the Hebrew alphabet. And the light of this candle would shine into the diamonds on his shoulder and radiate into the golden candlestick one letter at a time and spell out the specific will of God for the nation of Israel. When the high priest came out of the tabernacle and he came out and he said, Moses, God wants us to break camp. He said, we've gone around this mountain long enough. It's time to go to the promised land. He didn't go in there and rub his arthritic Baptist elbow and said, I feel led. I mean, he knew what God wanted them to do. Now, how many of you would like to have a personal revelation from God about what he wants you to do? Let me see your hand. It's in your Bible. It's in your Bible. If Jesus were in my place today, he wouldn't say anything that's not in that Bible. He spelled it out for them right here. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh, and the Word dwelt among you. The Word and the will of God are one and the same thing. Revelation is something you must have to live in the perfect will of God. It will keep you from major mistakes in your life. Let me give you an illustration. On one occasion in my life years ago, a man came into my office and he had a little jewelry box about that long and about that high. And he said, this is a birthday gift for you. And I opened it and it was full of $100 bills. There was $20,000 in there. And I had a financial need at that time that was eating my lunch. And I needed every dime of that money. And as soon as I looked at it, God said, don't you take it. I'm going to tell you, my German instinct came right to the top and said, that's the devil telling me that. Get away from me, devil. And the Lord said, don't you touch that money. I put the lid back. I called my wife in the office. I called the church treasurer in while he was there. And I said, we're going to give this to the church treasurer because we're trying to put together a trip to come to Israel to bring our choir for the first time. And I said, a lot of them can't pay their way. And I said, we're going to use this to pay their way to go to Israel. He looked at me and turned as red as fire. And I could tell that he was angry, but I couldn't tell why. At that point in time, he had a mail order business that I didn't know, that he did know, but it was illegal. What he was doing. 6 months later, the federal government filed charges on him. He was taken to court. It was on the front page of the newspaper. Guess who was the first person the federal government subpoenaed to talk, to testify? They brought me to the stand and said, didn't this man personally give you money? I said, he didn't give me a dime. I gave every dime that he put in my hand in the treasury of the church. I was off that stand in less than 2 minutes, and their case went down the tubes because of the revelation power of the Word of God. Now, the Holy of Holies. This is the type of the Holy Spirit. This is the sense dimension. This is where you get there only by your carnal logic. This is revelation, the soul. This is the Holy of Holies, the Spirit, the direct revelation of God through the Shekinah glory. This is the objective of the believer, to get in the presence of God. Think of how many believers you know live in the outer court. They're unhappy Christians. They're never happy about anything. They're at the brazen altar. They're at the laver. They're not living in the dimension that God wants for them. I'm telling you, until you get into this inner court, and you don't get into the inner court without praise and worship and prayer, but you get here and God gives you the revelation of what he wants you to be. I have known of businessmen who were praying and seeking for an answer, and God gave them a revelation that turned their business from just an ordinary business to a super achieving business because of the revelation of God. The tabernacle is also a picture of the believer. The tabernacle was the center of the camp. If you ever see a diagram of the encampment of the children of Israel, you'll find that all of the tribes are camped around this because it was important that the presence of God be directly in the center of the camp. It's important for you to understand that Jesus Christ is the center of your life, or he's nothing in your life. Jesus Christ is either the Lord of all, or he's not Lord at all. Jesus is either Lord or liar in your life. He is either first or he's nothing. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. The Bible says, you shall have no other gods before me. Revelation 1, 2, 12, and 3 says, I turned to see the voice that spoke to me in the midst, meaning in the center of the seven lampstands, and it was likened to the Son of God. The point is, in the Old Testament, God presents himself in the tabernacle as the center of the believer's life. The last thing he's writing about in the book of Revelation, that he is still the center of people's life. I'm saying to you, if Christ is not the center, if he's not the center of your marriage, if he's not the center of your church, if he's not the center of your speech, if he's not the center of your thought, then he's not the center of your life. And if he's not the center of your life, he is neither Lord nor Savior to you. That's who he has to be. Now look at this white fence, because this white fence speaks volumes. Imagine that had you been walking across this desert out here, and you had walked upon the children of Israel thousands of years ago and seen them in their encampment. And here around are at least 2 million people living in tents that are black with desert dirt. And suddenly, right in the middle, you see this beautiful white fence made from Egyptian cotton. And these 56 posts that have a silver cap, a brass base made of a seal wood. And you see this beautiful gate here that is the entrance of there. What is God saying in this fence? First, this white fence that is there is a demonstration of a very clear line of separation. You're either inside or you're outside of that fence. You're not sort of saved any more than you can be sort of pregnant. You either are or you're not. How many of you are understanding what I'm saying here? You're either on the outside of this fence looking in, or you're on the inside looking out. You hear people say, well, I'm sort of a believer. No, you're not. You're not any more saved than a goat in a hailstorm. You're lost and without God. Well, my wife goes to church. Well, your wife is going to heaven and you're going to hell. Well, I don't believe in hell. That's too bad. It's still there and you're still going. It's just that simple. We live in a society that emulates what was happening around that camp. When the children of Israel were encamped on the desert, and the desert winds were blowing, their tents were black. They didn't have to try to be black. They couldn't help but be black because of all the dust and the dirt that was in the air. The Israelites did not have to roll in the dirt to be dirty. The winds were blowing the dirt through the air, and the dirt was in the atmosphere. And so we as a people, passing across this wilderness called life toward the promised land called heaven, we live in a society that the very atmosphere is filled with moral and spiritual dirt. There's an environment of drugs and divorce and delinquency and rape and murder and incest and homosexuality and abortion and pornography and Satanism. And when you read the Word of God, this is dirt. It's in the atmosphere. All you have to do is turn on the television and it's there. You watch a movie and the movies no longer are about the things of life that are near to us, like love and so forth. Now if you watch a movie, it has a politically correct theme that is generally just as filth can be. Novels are filled with the filth. Our speech on the street, you just listen to people converse. Dirt requires a constant cleansing, and that constant cleansing is made possible through the washing of the laver, which is right here. This was filled with water, and every time the priest went from this brazen altar into the tabernacle, he had to wash his hands and his feet. He didn't do it once a day. He did it many times a day. I want you to get this point very clearly. He could not go into the house of God unless he was clean. David said, who shall ascend into the house of God? He that hath clean hands. And he was talking about that right there. I ask the American audience who are watching this, how in heaven's name can you watch 40 hours of television filled with one rape and one violent scene after another and one murder after another and one salacious sexual scene after another, watch that all week long and bop into the house of God on Sunday morning and expect to get in the presence of God? You can't get there. Again, this white fence is the sign of the righteousness of the kingdom of God. This fence is a separation. You're on the inside or you're on the outside. You are saved or lost. Jesus said, I have come to bring a sword. A sword divides. This fence divides. You're either saved or lost. You're either sheep or goats. You are light or darkness. You are wheat or tares. You're walking the narrow way that leads to heaven or the broad way that leads to hell. You need to ask yourself, watching this telecast, what side of this fence am I on? The church is filled with people who profess Christ, but do not possess Christ. They've gone under the water in the baptismal tank, but they're not under the blood. They talk the talk, but they don't walk the walk. It's time for America to ask themselves, who is on the Lord's side? James says, a friend of the world is the enemy of God. If you are at peace with the world, then you're of the world. If the world likes you, that's because you're like them. Jesus said, if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father and his angels which are in heaven. And let me tell you something. All you have to do is keep your mouth shut to deny the Son of God. What side of this fence are you on? In the Bible, white linen signifies righteousness. Revelation 19 and 8 says, and to her, speaking of the church, was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, white and clean, for the fine white linen is the righteousness of the saints. Righteousness literally breaks down to mean right living. Psalms 45 and 7, God loves righteousness. God loves right living. Say that with me. God loves right living. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you. Your prosperity is totally locked up in your willingness to do the right thing. Beloved, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospers. Your soul can't prosper unless it's righteous. And when your soul prospers, then you prosper financially, emotionally, maritally, socially, relationally, in every other way. All of your righteousness is as filthy rags. You can't try to make yourself clean. That's self-righteousness. That's what the Pharisees did. Let me talk to you about legalism and righteousness. Because many of you watching this telecast, and maybe some of you here, are doing this. Legalism is this. Legalism is keeping man-made religious rules to obtain righteousness with God. All you have to do to be righteous, according to the book of Romans, is believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for your sins, that he rose from the dead, and that he sits at the right hand of God the Father. The Bible says if you believe that, you are righteous. But some of you are teaching in your various churches that ladies have to have dresses that are so long before they can be righteous, and they have to look a certain way before they can be righteous. Listen, sweetheart, I don't care if your hair is long enough for you to sit on. I don't care if your dress looks like you got off wagon train. If you have a tongue that's as long as a barbed wire fence, you are self-righteous, but you cannot be righteous until you are made righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ. You don't get righteous, he makes you righteous. Genesis 3, Adam and Eve were separated from God because of sin. And I'm talking about now finding a way to make yourself righteous. And remember that they made for themselves clothes of leaves. And God found them and rejected it. And God went and brought to them bloody animal skins and covered themselves with the skins of animals. And all of you PETA friends out there listening to this, it's written in the Word of God. God did that. Now, what's the message here? God early on is saying, the wages of sin is death, but my plan of redemption is that the shed blood of the Lamb is going to die, and the blood of the Lamb is going to cover you of your sin. You can't do something in yourself to save yourself. You can't crawl down the aisle of a cathedral to save yourself. You can't crawl down the aisle of a cathedral and kiss the toe of St. Peter and be healed. The blood of Jesus Christ heals you. You can't join a church and expect to go to heaven. Joining a church makes you no more a child of God than a bath, a bar of soap, and a red ribbon make a pig a poodle. That just doesn't happen. The only way you can be saved is through the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed on the cross for our redemption. Give the Lord praise in the house. The white linen fence, let's go back to that. Each of these pillars, notice that they're in an absolutely straight line. Remember again that this is something that's on earth, that's a replica of what's in heaven. They're in an absolutely straight line. This is a physical expression of unity. Jesus said when he was praying to the Father about you and me, he said, Father, that they may be one, even as you and I are one. Why? So that the world may know that you sent me. So that the world may know you sent me. And let me tell you something. The church in America really hasn't done anything to make the world believe that Jesus is in us because of the constant bickering in the church and church to church. Let me tell you something. The devil is our enemy. We're not each other. The battle is not between us and us. It's between us and the prince of darkness. We need to get together here and recognize that we're the army of the living God. We need to come into unity and fight the prince of darkness. David said in Psalms 133, how beautiful it is when brethren dwell together in unity. For there the Lord will command a blessing. Let me tell you something. The only way your church will ever be blessed is when they all get into unity and they begin to do what the Word and the will of God says. As soon as you teach something like this, someone says, well, does that mean we all have to think alike? No, when everyone thinks alike, someone's not thinking. And if you and someone else see something exactly alike, one of you is not necessary. It doesn't mean that we all have to be alike. It means that we have to be unified around the cross of Jesus Christ, that He's the Lord and He's the Savior. He's the reason we're here. But I want to press this on even to the book of Revelation. These pillars, when God is speaking to the seven churches of Asia, He said, if you're faithful unto death, I will make you a pillar in the kingdom of God. Now, what does that mean? I believe the illustration begins right here and ends in the book of Revelation. Because in the time of Christ and in the time of Paul, if you did something as a citizen that was of great monumental importance, they named a pillar after you in the name of one of their great buildings. These great columns, Corinthian crowned, right under there would be your name. That meant you did something very outstanding. God began here in symbolism and saying, and finally closed in the book of Revelation saying, if you are faithful and serve me in unity, when I come to rule and reign and set up my kingdom, I'm going to give you a place of honor in my kingdom. You're going to rule and reign with me the length and breadth of the earth. I'm really not excited about the next presidential election because it really doesn't make any difference who gets elected. Not much is going to change. But I'm going to tell you something. When Jesus Christ comes back to earth and He rules and reigns from the city of Jerusalem, there's going to be some changes made, pal. That's my team. These posts are out of a sea of wood. And I have a picture of that post right here. This is a singular picture of what I'm saying here. This is cedar wood grew in the desert. Obviously, this is where the children of Israel are. They're in the desert. This is the only place they can get that wood. That wood literally grew up out of the desert. It's like Jesus Christ, because the Bible says He is a dry root. He is a tree that grew out of a dry root. And then this wood was virtually indestructible. Let me tell you something, that Jesus Christ is absolutely indestructible. He's the Alpha and the Omega. What does that mean? That means in Genesis 1, he was in power. He was the creator of heaven and earth. And that means when the last dirt settles in the last book of Revelation, he is still the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and there's none likened unto him in the heavens above or on the earth or in the worlds beneath. Give the Lord a mighty shout in the house of God. This symbol of brass, and I'm going to say this many times in many ways, this is a brass base on every one of these poles. Brass speaks of judgment. Say that with me. Brass speaks of judgment. This altar here is completely made of brass. It speaks of judgment. From the front gate to the back gate, there is the expression of the judgment of God. Why? Because God is a God of judgment. In the flood of Noah, he proved one thing once and for all. I'm the judge of all the earth. I don't have to have the Supreme Court's permission to make a decision. I'm the boss here. I'm the Lord of all. God says in Scripture there are five judgments. The first judgment is the judgment for sin that was taken care of at the cross. And because of the cross, I'm free from sin. I don't have to worry about sin. Sin has forever been defeated by the blood of Jesus Christ. The next judgment is the judgment seat of Christ that Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians. He says that every believer must appear. You don't have a choice. We must appear before the Lord Jesus Christ and give an account of everything we've said, everything we've done on this earth. That means if you're a believer, there's a day you're going to give an account for everything you have done or haven't done. You're going to answer for the gap that exists between where you are and where you should have been had you followed the Word of God. And then next, there's going to be the judgment of the nations. Whenever Christ comes back to this earth and he sets up his kingdom, the very first judgment is going to be the judgment of the nations. What does that mean? That means the basis of this judgment is how the nations of the world treated the Jewish people and specifically Israel. And I want you to listen to this, America. And I want you to listen to this, nations of the world. This is going to happen right here in the nation of Israel. God is going to call the nations of the earth and he's going to make them answer for the way in which they've treated the Jewish people. I think it's very important that the Pope, who was recently here, ask for forgiveness, because it certainly was a necessary thing. When you understand what happened to the Jewish people in the Crusades, seven of them, where Jews were killed from Europe all the way to Jerusalem, and the first crusade invaded the city of Jerusalem and gathered up 969 Jewish men, women, and children and set the synagogue on fire. And while the crusaders marched around that synagogue, setting it on fire, and those people were screaming and begging for their lives, literally being burned alive, they sang, "Christ, we adore thee." There were seven crusades from Europe to Jerusalem and from Jerusalem back to Europe, the purpose of which was to rob, to rape, and to destroy the Jewish people. Many of the American people don't even know American history, let alone church history. The Spanish Inquisition was one of the greatest acts of extortion ever in the history of the world, where the Roman Church literally put on trial the dead bones of Jewish people, and because those dead bones couldn't defend themselves, they extorted all of their family wealth and put it in the coffers of the church. There's coming a day of judgment for that. There's a payday someday. And don't you ever forget it. God is not excusing anything. That will answer. There's going to be an answering for that. There's going to be a judgment of Israel. This is a wonderful, precious land. But most of the people who live here are secular humanists. They don't believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But I assure you, they're going to meet him. And those who have lived outside the Word of God or the Torah of God are going to give an answer of that. And then the fifth judgment is the great white throne judgment. So those of you who are watching and saying, "Well, I'm not a Christian, so I'm not going to the judgment seat of Christ," you are going to the great white throne judgment. The great white throne judgment is where the Bible says there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Why? Because those people know that they're already going to be sentenced. They have been released from hell, and they're coming to be formally sentenced, and they'll return to the lake of fire, and they'll be there forever and forever and forever. It's not a matter of if you're going to bow to the Son of God. It's just a matter of when you're going to bow to the Son of God. Now, let me give you a very real illustration of the thing that brings the judgment of God most quickly, and that is the attacking of spiritual authority. Anytime that you as a person attack spiritual authority, it brings the judgment of God with lightning force. In Numbers the 16th chapter, Korah, Dathan, and Abram murmured against Moses, so Moses called a meeting. And he said, let all who agree with these people who are spreading stories about me that are not true, I want you to all come into one place. And so they all came into one place before the tent of the meeting, which is the tabernacle. And the Bible says, and God opened the earth and swallowed 250 of them and closed the earth. And all of Israel said, woo-wee, don't do that again. Immediately they got the picture. When you open your mouth against spiritual authority, you bring the judgment of God. In Numbers 21, the children of Israel murmured against God and against Moses, and God sent servants into the camp, and thousands of them died. Let me tell you something. Murmuring, which is negative speech, releases demonic powers to control your life and to destroy you. Rachel Epstein the other day gave me a book written by a world-famous rabbi, and one-third of that book is written about the power of negative speech. I don't tell you it's absolutely biblical and totally profound, but murmuring releases a negative force that will destroy you. When you say something like, I hate this day, I wish I could die, I don't want to have this baby, I don't like my husband, I don't like my wife, instantly you release demonic powers that are empowered to destroy your life. I'm telling you, stop it, because you're tearing your life apart. The Bible says the power of life and death is in the tongue. And the solution to the snakes, remember, every time that Israel murmured, God sent snakes and let the snakes bite the people who murmured. Let me tell you something. If God released snakes in every murmuring church in America this next Sunday, the churches of America would look like a snake garden. And the only way that they could be stopped is that a brass serpent was put on a pole and lifted, and Moses said, look and live. It was typified of the time that Jesus would be lifted on a cross. He would be taking our judgment. He is the great physician. And if you want to know what the symbol of a doctor is to this day, it's a brass snake wrapped around a pole, a symbol of a healer. Jesus Christ is still the great physician, and the only way you can release his power, one of the ways you release his healing power into your life is to shut your negative mouth. And all of God's children said, oh me. It was a foreshadowing of the day that Christ was lifted up on the cross, because he took our judgment for all of our sin. I had death, but he gave to me everlasting life. At the cross was the place of great exchange. I had sickness, but by his stripes I am healed. I had poverty, but by the riches of Abraham I now can prosper beyond measure. I was an outcast outside the covenants of Israel, and God adopted me and made his very own. And all of these things happen through the cross. The last picture we have of Jesus Christ is in the book of Revelation. And his head is white like wool. And his eyes are as a flame of fire. And his feet are like what? Brass. Say it with me. Brass. Because there's brass here, there's brass here, there's brass here, and there's brass on his feet in the book of Revelation. Why? Because he's getting ready to release his judgment on the world in the tribulation period of time. And he's getting ready to pour out upon the world a level of his judgment that they have never known. We have taught in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John a gentle, meek Jesus until America no longer knows the real Jesus. But the real Jesus is in the book of Revelation. He is the Lamb of God in the book of Matthew. In the book of Revelation, he's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. In Matthew, he is a teacher of love and mercy and grace. In the book of Revelation, his eyes are like fire, his feet are like brass, and he is speaking of the judgment that he's getting ready to release upon the earth. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. He is the bread of life. He is the milk for new believers. He is meat for men. He is the fairest of 10,000. He is the bright in the morning star. He is Emmanuel, God with us. He is the wonderful Counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Lord of glory, the light of the world, the Lion of Judah, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. And he's coming back right here to rule and reign on this earth, giving praise in the house of God. These silver caps speak of redemption. Every one of these caps, these posts, are covered with silver. It speaks of God's plan of redemption. You can read this in your Bibles tonight. But in Exodus, the 30th chapter, God said to the children of Israel that the symbol and the price of redemption was silver. And so they had to bring silver for the redemption of the firstborn son. The message was, every person has to be redeemed. The message was, the price is the same, whether you are rich or poor, the price is the same. But Jesus Christ came as the firstborn son, and he proved he was the firstborn son when he mixed dirt and spittle in his hand. Why did he do that? Because the Jewish people believed that there was healing power in the spittle of the firstborn son. And when he spit into his hand and he mixed it and he put it into the eyes of the blind man and he went and washed and he came away seeing, every Jewish person who saw that said, this is the Son of God. He is the firstborn of the Father. He is who he said he was. And then Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 5, for Christ was our Passover, was sacrificed for us once and for all. Let me tell you something. While I was researching for the book, His Glory Revealed, out of Jewish history comes this marvelous story that the high priest, when they would take the blood of the goat, there was two goats. One was a scapegoat and the other goat was slaughtered. And when they would take the scapegoat out into the wilderness, they would take a crimson ribbon and tie it to the gatepost of the tabernacle, and then take the scapegoat out and throw him over a cliff to die. And whenever he died, this crimson ribbon, year after year after year, would instantly and miraculously turn white. For Isaiah said, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. But then they made this footnote, meant nothing to them. It was a footnote in history. But 40 years after the destruction of the temple, this stopped. What happened? Jesus had died on the cross. And when they shoved the scapegoat over the edge, nothing happened. Why? Because redemption was no longer through the blood of goats and bullocks. It was through the blood of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, that taketh away the sins of the world. The three entrances to the tabernacle speak of Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life. The first entrance is right here. The second entrance is right here. And the third entrance is right here before the Holy of Holies. It's the veil. You can't see it because you have to see the Holy of Holies. But the third one is right here. The first curtain on the outer court says, Jesus is the way. This, notice how that this is the only way in here. There's not four gates around here. There's one gate. Why? Because Jesus says, I am the way, and no one cometh unto the Father but by me. There are four posts here. Why? Because there are four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Stay with that for just a moment as we go through that, because that's very important. Jesus Christ as the way. John 10 and 9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. John 14 and 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Acts 4 and 12, there is no other name given among men whereby we might be saved. There is one door, there is one way, and there is no other name. What does that mean? That means Buddha cannot save you. That means Mohammed cannot save you. That means Mary cannot save you. That means Joseph Smith cannot save you. That means Mr. Moon from over in Korea cannot save you. That means wealth and power cannot save you. That means that Jesus Christ is not among the ways. He is the only way. If you don't come in through this door, you don't get in, because He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the way into the presence of the Son of God. John 10:1 says, Verily I say unto you, he that enters not by the door of the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. That means that every cult on the face of the earth is a thief and a robber. That means there's a counterfeit Christianity in America. That means secular humanism is a thief and a robber. That means they're teaching you another way. The New Testament speaks of the doctrine of demons. Let me tell you what a doctrine of demons is. The doctrine of demons is anyone who teaches you how to get to heaven other than through Jesus Christ. And there are preachers in America that I call feel-good preachers. They tell you how to feel good without being good. It's never, ever necessary to admit that you're wrong and that you need to repent. We just want you to feel good about yourself and think good thoughts. Let me tell you something. You can think good thoughts and go straight to hell. Thinking good thoughts don't save you. The blood of Jesus Christ saves you. The blood of Jesus Christ saves you. Anyone who teaches you anything about getting to heaven other than through Jesus Christ is teaching you the doctrine of demons. It is not possible. It's a counterfeit Christianity. Paul said that in the last days, men would be lovers of themselves more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness and denying the power thereof. Listen to the next phrase. From such turn away. Say that with me. From such turn away. That means get out of that church. It has nothing for you but death. It's a counterfeit Christianity, and it will never lead you to the kingdom of God. Many are trying to come through some other door, thinking good thoughts, feeling good about yourself, some kind of psycho-cybernetics, some kind of Eastern meditation. But it'll never happen. Without Christ in your life, you're lost. Notice how wide this gate is. It's 30 feet wide. It's 7.5 feet tall. Why? I call it the whosoever will gate. Because Jesus said, whosoever will, let him come. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The message of the fence is that you have to stay out. But the message of the gate is there's a way in, and that way in is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. God wants you to come in. He makes it wide enough to get in. Notice that the gate has four colors. There's white, purple, blue, and scarlet. White is the color of righteousness, for Christ was without spot or wrinkle. What kind of church is Jesus coming back for? A church without spot or wrinkle. We're supposed to be like Him, not like each other. The second color is purple. It's the sign of royalty. Why? Because Jesus Christ is King of kings and Lord of lords. The wise men came seeking for Him, saying, we've come to worship Him who is King of the Jews. The third is blue, which is the color of heaven that tells the children of Israel where their God lived. For 400 years they'd been living in Egypt, and there was hundreds of gods that you could reach and touch. But every time they saw the color of blue, it reminded them, our Father which art in heaven. Say that with me. Our Father which art in heaven. Our God is in heaven. And He reigns with power and glory. And then scarlet is the color of blood. And blood is the price of redemption. We sing the song, there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilt and stain. There are four colors applied to Christ. Present Him in the full way that He's presented in the Gospels. Ezekiel 1 and 10 also presents the four faces of the man of God, and they go together. Ezekiel 1 and 10 said, the likeness of the face is the face of a man, the face of a lion, the face of an ox, and the face of an eagle. Now follow this and stay with me and consecrate very hard here. There are four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that present Jesus in four different ways. Ezekiel 1 and 10 presents Jesus in four different ways. Put them together because the gospel puts them together as was first revealed in the tabernacle. In Matthew, Jesus is presented as the king, which corresponds to the color, representing Christ as the king of Israel. This is the face of the lion in Ezekiel because Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah. In Mark, he is represented as a servant, and he's presented as the color scarlet. Christ was the suffering servant. There are two messiahs. The first one is a suffering servant, and the second one that's coming again is reigning with power and majesty. This is Ezekiel's face of an ox. An ox is a faithful, plodding, enduring animal. He will plow and plow and plow. You put him up in the next day and he plows and plows and plods and fulfills the will of his master. Let me tell you something. You and I are servants of God, and sometimes what we do requires plowing and plodding and plowing and plodding. But God says, if you're faithful unto death, I will give you the crown of life. In Luke, Jesus is presented as the perfect man in the color of the radiant white. This is Ezekiel's face of a man. Jesus was man. He was God. He was born of the Virgin Mary, but he was the seed of the living God. In John, Jesus is presented as God. John presents us as the color of blue, presenting Christ as the Son of God sent from heaven. This is Ezekiel's eagle, for an eagle is destined to sail in the heavens, high above mortal men, being in the presence of God. Isaiah said, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, and they shall mount on wings of eagles. Why are there four Gospels? Why not just one? Because there were four people on the earth at the time of Christ. There were first the Jewish people. And Jesus said of the Jewish people in John 4:22, salvation is of the Jews. Say that with me. Salvation is of the Jews. There's not one preacher in 100 understands that verse of Scripture. Here's what it means. It means that the Jewish people gave us the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It means the Jewish people gave us the prophets, Isaiah, Nehemiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, every one of them Jewish. There's not one Southern Baptist in the lot. It means Mary, Joseph, and Jesus, the first family of Christianity, that they were Jewish. The disciples were Jewish. Paul was Jewish. Every book in the Bible was written by Jewish hands. That means if you take away the Word of God, Mary, Joseph, and Jesus, the disciples, all the patriarchs, when you take the Jewish contribution away from Christianity, there is no Christianity. Let me tell you something. We have a great deal of debt to pay to the Jewish people for what they have given to us. Secondly, there were the Romans who had conquered Israel, and they were the symbol of power. Thirdly, there were the Greeks who gave the world its language. I believe that God allowed Alexander the Great to conquer the world so that the New Testament could be written in Greek. Why? Because the English language is a very... it's a very confusing language. There's nothing exact about it. You can say, I love you. What does that mean? It means everything. It means nothing. I've heard girls say, well, he walks in the room, I can't breathe. It's asthma, sweetheart. It's not love. But when you read the Greek language, there are seven words for love. And when you see in any one of those seven words, you know exactly what kind of love you're talking about there. But you can't get that out of the English language. That's why the Word of God is such an exact book. People say, well, I don't understand the Bible. It'd help if you'd read it. It'd help more if you knew the author. Fourthly, there was a small group of believers who later became known as the Christians. So Matthew is written to the Jews. Mark was written to Romans. Luke was written to the Greeks. John is addressed to the church. And these are the reasons that there are four Gospels addressed in four different ways so that we could recognize the purposes of God. Now, the last thing I want to say about this fence and close, because we've been here an hour, and I'll pick it up at our next session here. Notice that this gate faces to the east. Faces to the east. When the wise men came seeking Jesus, there were wise men who came from the east. The Bible says, as lightning shines from the east to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. When Christ comes to earth a second time, he's not coming to Rome. He's not coming to Washington. He's coming right here. He's going to set his kingdom up in the east, right here. Let me give you this. When I was in graduate school, and I'm talking about the verse, as lightning shines from the east to the west, I read a report one day that was a manual written by a weatherman that says, when lightning flashes from the east to the west, it means the storm is over. The Bible says when Jesus comes, the lightning will shine as though from the east to the west. When Jesus comes, the storm is over, and there will be peace and tranquility on the face of the earth, when the lion shall lay down with the lamb, and he shall be Lord of all. With the Lord a mighty shout, can we stand together? Give a mighty shout and a mighty praise in the house of God.
Many in the tour also chose to extend their trip into Jordan and the rose-red city of Petra. There, Pastor Hagee gave a brief history and a look into the future of this fascinating site.
I'm standing at Petra. Petra is one of the most natural fortresses on the earth. This certainly has to be one of the eight wonders of the world. This is a natural fortress that Bible prophecy says the nation of Israel will flee to during the time of the Great Tribulation, when the Antichrist drives them from the city of Jerusalem to this natural fortress. When you begin to come into this fortress for 1 mile, you walk through passages that only two or three men can walk shoulder to shoulder coming in, meaning that once the children of Israel or the Jewish people are in this place, that no army can chase them in here, because no army could get a tank or even a jeep up this long, winding, narrow passage. And the walls of this massive fortress go up hundreds of feet straight up into the air, that even though we are in the desert, you cannot see the sun because the walls are so high and so close together. The Bible says in Revelation 12 that there is going to be a war against the woman, and the woman is expectant with child, and that child obviously is Jesus Christ. It is born, the Bible says, goes into heaven, is taken into heaven, and then that child becomes a nation, speaking of Israel, and war is made against the children of Israel, and they come here. Now what you're seeing behind me is the treasury. This is a facade, meaning something that was chiseled out of the side of the mountain. It was chiseled there by Arabic people called the Nabataeans in the Hellenistic period, which was 400 years before Christ, during the time of Christ, and 100 years after the time of Christ. One of the things that I think of when I walk down this 1 mile channel and I see these massive walls, all of this has been cut out by water over a process of millions of years, that God Almighty, the Alpha and the Omega, was preparing this place as a fortress for the Jewish people to hide from the Antichrist even before he called Abraham. Think about that. God, knowing the beginning and the end from the beginning, began to have the waters flow through these mountains to dig this massive channel so narrow that no army could pursue the Jewish people. And once they are here, they're totally safe from any military power that the Antichrist would be able to control. You find the mention of this place in Isaiah 16, where there is Selah, the rock. That's Hebrew for the rock. And Isaiah 42:10 through 14, and 2 Kings 14 and 7. There is absolutely no doubt that this is the rock fortress that the Jewish people will run to after 3.5 years, because get the sequence in mind. The Antichrist is going to rise to power. He will come as a man of peace. He will cause craft to prosper. He will cause all to take the sign in their forehead or right hand so that they can buy and sell. And then following that, he's going to make a treaty with Israel. But in 3.5 years, he's going to break that treaty. He's going to be shot in the head, and the Bible said he's going to recover wondrously, emulating the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And then from that, he will set his image up to be worshipped. But when he is shot in the head, he's going to become Hitler reborn. And the Jews in Israel that are still loyal to the law of Moses are going to flee to this place. And the people that have come to know the Lord from the preachings of the 144,000 will also come here. And they are going to be preserved by the hand of God for 3.5 years. What makes the Antichrist leave here? The thing that makes him leave here is the Bible says that he will hear tidings from the east that trouble him. And the tidings from the east is the fact that marching up the Euphrates River will be the Chinese army of 200 million people who will be coming to the Battle of Armageddon. The Antichrist will leave here, get his military forces prepared to meet the Chinese army that is coming down to the Battle of Armageddon. And there is going to be the final fight for world domination, of which Revelation 19 very clearly says that Christ comes to earth for the second time, followed by the armies which are in heaven, and he will establish his kingdom upon this earth. But we are looking at the natural fortress that God has prepared, beginning to prepare millions of years ago, and now in just a very few short days, as far as history is concerned, will become the natural fortress for the Jewish people when the Antichrist wages war against them and the angel Michael defends them by the hand of God. This is Petra, the natural fortress that God himself has prepared to defend the Jewish people.